It's Wrestling at the Chase. Featuring the top names in the world of wrestling. And now, let's go to ringside and your announcer, Larry Madison.
Welcome to a special edition of Wrestling at the Chase. Hello, I'm Larry Madison, and today we'll taste the icing on the cake with the best of Wrestling at the Chase. During the past year, there have been many stars and many highlights, and we'll be taking a look at a lot of those during the next hour. You know, wrestling is in its 22nd year on Channel 11, and during that period, nearly every major star in the world has appeared right here on KPLR-TV. Just take a look at some of the names on display today. And certainly, one of the most impressive is Ken Patera, who is currently the Missouri State Champion. One of the strongest men in the world, Patera made his St. Louis television debut this past spring against Terry Shaw. So let's join that action in progress as powerhouse Ken Patera tangles with Terry Shaw.
Patera squeezing Shaw. Shaw jammed the heels of his hands into the ears of Patera. Patera then ducks his head so that he can put his head against the solar plexus of Shaw. Patera lifts Shaw, look at that, 280 pounds, and Patera just pitches him into the corner. Patera with a knee to the back of Terry Shaw. Patera driving that knee home one more time.
2 minutes left, 2 minutes.
Patera covering Shaw, but Shaw kicks free, gets an arm up. Patera moves behind Shaw, clamps on the full Nelson, and there's the swinging neckbreaker. Oh, can you believe how Patera's pitching that big man around? The swinging neckbreaker now into the full Nelson, cramming the neck forward, and Shaw may have no choice but to give up. He does. Terry Shaw submits.
Watch what happened when Patera met Bob Hayes and Jose Martinez in a handicap tag match.
Hayes grabs Patera's other arm. Between the two of them, Martinez and Hayes, they managed to flip Patera over. They both cover Patera. Oh, and Patera lifts both men off him with a bench press of his own. Martinez says, oh my God, as he rolls to the apron. There were, let's see, 226. There were close to 460 pounds on Patera. Patera lifted both men off of him. Patera flexes out those legs, knocks Martinez right through the ropes.
Patera's power allowed him to take command of the match.
The needed Patera sucker Hayes. Patera lifts Hayes right over his head and slams Hayes. Tremendous body slam by Ken Patera. Then the elbow drop. Count of two, Hayes kicks away. Martinez falls off the apron after some of the pounding he's taken from Patera, although really Martinez has looked very sharp against Ken Patera and has given Patera some trouble. Hard forearm smash from Patera, laying those forearms home. Hayes off the ropes. Clothesline right underneath the chin by Ken Patera. Patera moving behind Hayes. There's a full Nelson. If he can lift him up and spin him, there it is, the swinging neck breaker from Ken Patera, whirling the man around, all the pressure into Hayes' neck. Hayes having no choice but to submit. And Bob Hayes submits, so Ken Patera is the winner of this handicap tag match over Martinez and Hayes. The swinging neck breaker applied off the full Nelson, again doing the job for Ken Patera.
Stories was the alliance between Gene Kaniski and the Von Erich brothers, Kevin and David. Here is that trio in a six-man tag affair.
Kruger, Van and Wright have been triple-teaming every chance they get. Kaniski made the tag with David, and Kaniski still wants a piece of Kruger. Kaniski and David Von Erich double-teaming Kruger. Kaniski is angry, wow, to say the least. David yells for Kevin, and Kevin puts the knee up, and the knee meets Kruger's head. Kaniski approves. Both Von Erichs in the ring. They whip Kruger to the ropes. David ducks, and Kevin nails Kruger with a drop kick. There were Von Erichs all over that ring. Up it, up above it, on the mat, everywhere. There was a Von Erich for Kruger. Knee lift to the stomach by Kevin on Bobby Van. Elbow elbow smash to the neck by Kevin Von Erich. Kevin goes to the body scissors, rolls it over. This could be the pin, the rolling body scissors by Kevin Von Erich.
Kaniski and the Von Erichs were no less awesome in the second stanza.
His teammates can't make it. Kaniski hooks the arms into surfboard position. Want a shot at him, says Kaniski. David does. And David belts Larry Wright. Tag made from Kaniski to Kevin Von Erich. Kevin lines up that elbow and drives it into the back of the head of Larry Wright. Kevin goes for the pin on right. Count of one, Kruger there again to break it up. Kevin Von Erich wants to take a shot at Kruger. Kaniski says, forget him, go after the man here. The cool caginess of Gene Kaniski, the experience helping to make this trio, well, looks almost unbeatable. Double drop kick! Double drop kick by the Von Erichs! With drop kicks, David Von Erich. Did he get the pin on right? Yes, he did. There's the second fall. Round to the mat.
Do you remember the Donnybrook that erupted when Kaniski and Kevin Von Erich clashed with Bulldog Bob Brown and Dick Murdoch?
Kaniski and Von Erich double team the Bulldog briefly. Tag made to Kaniski. And Kaniski's after Brown. Kaniski with a knee to the neck. Another knee by Gene Kaniski, the former world champion. Flying mare by Kaniski, and then he uses Brown's face like a doorstep. Kaniski goes for the pin. Brown throws him off. Murdoch stays in to kick Kaniski in the head. Kevin's after Murdoch. Brown working on the throat of Kaniski, drops Kaniski. Brown slams Kaniski's head into the top buckle, and Brown tags Murdoch. Kaniski misses with that punch to the stomach, and then Murdoch drops Kaniski with a series of kicks. Kaniski whipped to the ropes by Dick Murdoch, and Murdoch catches Kaniski with an elbow underneath the chin. Brown yells, this is it. No, not yet. Kaniski's made of stern stuff. Kaniski trying to get to Kevin Von Erich, makes the tag. Kevin with a knee lift to the stomach. Kaniski holding Murdoch on those ropes for Kevin Von Erich.
3 minutes left, 3 minutes.
3 minutes left. Murdoch flipped up and over by Kevin Von Erich. Drop kick by Kevin, knocks Brown over the top rope. Drop kick by Kevin, floors Murdoch. Another drop kick. Murdoch manages to keep his feet. Kevin charging into Murdoch with tackles, but then Murdoch catches Von Erich and slams his head into the top buckle. Murdoch covering Kevin, the referee making a count of three. Kaniski and Brown battling over here. Was there a pin made? Yes, I thought he had him down for a count of three. The crowd's yelling that Murdoch used the ropes for the extra pin. Lee Warren trying to explain what has happened to referee Joe Tanguero. We couldn't see. Kaniski and Brown were battling in front of us. Tanguero's calling off that pin and starting the match up again. Lee Warren saved Von Erich from being pinned. Von Erich pitched out of the ring. Murdoch out after. That pin was called off because of what? Look out! Murdoch slammed into the press table by Kevin. Kaniski is battering Bulldog Brown in the far corner. We have it. There's the claw. The claw by Von Erich. The referee calling for the bell. Von Erich with the claw on Dick Murdoch outside the ring. Von Erich forcing the man down to the mat, down to the concrete floor. Kevin Von Erich still with the claw on Murdoch, and Murdoch catches Von Erich in the head with a microphone stand. Murdoch drives a microphone stand into the throat of Kevin Von Erich while Kaniski and Brown have a Donnybrook. Murdoch has the bell. He's trying to get at Kevin Von Erich with a bell. Joe Tanguero pushing him back. I think that Tanguero is not as qualified both men. Kevin Von Erich still trying to get at Murdoch. Kaniski and Brown had a war. Both men, I think, have been disqualified.
The youngest Von Erich, Carey, made his TV debut as Kevin's partner.
5 minutes left. 5 minutes.
5 minutes remain in the curfew. No falls yet. The Von Erich brothers, Carey and Kevin, against Real Guzman and Tom DeMarco. Guzman with a flying mare on Carey. Carey punches back. Drop kick by Carey. Oh, he takes to the air. Carey leapfrogs over the top. He has a jackknife and rolling cradle. And Guzman's over.
Stick around. Dory Funk Jr. is next.
Rolling cradle by Carey Von Erich. Gives the first fall to the Von Erich brothers.
So many other major stars, Dory Funk Jr. really started rolling right here in St. Louis. Eventually, Funk won the World Heavyweight Championship and held that honor for more than 4 years. Even today, Funk is regarded among the top contenders for wrestling's biggest prize. Dory Jr. was here last fall when he met Ron McFarlane. So let's join that action in progress. Ron McFarlane versus Dory Funk Jr.
Dory Jr. going for the pile driver on McFarlane. Dory Funk Jr. with the pile driver on Ron McFarlane. That could be curtains for Mr. McFarlane. Oh, he gets his foot to the bottom rope. McFarlane saving himself after the Greco-Roman back body drop, after the side saddle suplex, and then after the pile driver. Again, Riley makes a count, but now McFarlane's had a few seconds to more or less regain his composure. Front face lock by Dory Jr. on Ron McFarlane. It's interesting, McFarlane was flailing away. He had Dory Jr. trapped in the corner. Some of the punishment was legal. Some of it was not legal by McFarlane, but Dory Jr. has turned the match around with legal moves. He tries to go for the horizontal suplex. Can he get him up? Or rather, the vertical suplex, excuse me. He gets him up this time. Dory Funk Jr. with the suplex over the top. Shades of Harley Race. Dory Jr. going for the pin. This could be it. Count of two. Hey, give this McFarlane credit. He's taking some lumps from Dory Funk Jr. Legal lumps, which was a point to be made earlier. Count of one, two. McFarlane, if he wouldn't stay down after the first suplex, it's doubtful he'd just stay down for the body press. He's strong, he's young, he's aggressive, he's got stamina. Dory trying to keep the shoulders of McFarlane down, but right now it doesn't look like it's going to pay off for Dory Funk Jr., so he nicely slips into the arm bar. McFarlane heads for the ropes and tries to check if his spine is still in the same alignment that it was when this match started. McFarlane whipped to the ropes. Dory Jr. flips him over the top. Dory looks for the leg. Body drop to the knee. The spinning toe hold by Ron McFarlane, who's been worn down pretty much from all the suplexes. A body drop by Dory Funk Jr. And Ron McFarlane had no choice but to submit. Dory Funk Jr. showed exactly why he belongs to the top of any list of challengers for the World Heavyweight and Missouri State titles.
George Wells made a quick reputation thanks to actions such as in this handicap tag duel.
Lion tackle by George Wells. The hip toss again. Wells has got a good hip toss. He can strike with that from almost any position while he is standing.
This George Wells can be a good team man.
Oh, yes, sir. Let's see. We take Brody's drop kick. Take the Von Erich's drop kick. Take Wells' drop kick. We could have one dandy drop kicking contest.
And Joe Sullivan will be calling you for drop kicks.
I should say.
2 minutes left. 2 minutes.
2 minutes remain. Neither Wells by himself or the duo of McFarlane and Hall been able to come up with a fall. McFarlane scratched the eyes of Wells. And now Hall has the tag rope around Wells' throat. McFarlane pounds on Wells while Hall was strangling him. McFarlane drives that knee into the midsection of Wells. The tag was made. Here comes Steve Hall. Again, working on the stomach. Another quick tag. Here comes McFarlane. Hall and McFarlane double-teaming Wells, making quick tags, trying to take advantage of the edge they have in manpower. Wells fighting back with a forearm smash. Here comes Hall. He catches a fist right to the jaw. Oh, Wells catapults over the top away from both. Double drop kick. I'll say he hit two men with one drop kick. 1 foot for each man. A drop kick for both men. Wells, flying tackle. Flying tackle. Wells grabs the head of Hall.
1 minute.
Wells covers Hall and gets the count of three.
Dick the Bruiser, possibly the most dangerous wrestler of them all, was here to face Mike Boyer.
The fact that O'Connor was bleeding and hurt. On the other hand, I'm sure he was sorry to see the Bruiser come in because it did cost O'Connor the match by disqualification. But Pat has been around. He understands the Bruiser. He understands what furies are burning right now in him, boy, what temper is frayed right there, and he can understand why the Bruiser did what he did. The Bruiser's not going to need much of an excuse to come after Murdoch at any time, believe me.
Sure, he's right on his trail. He just follows him around.
And Murdoch did the same thing to the Bruiser for a couple months. The Bruiser pitches Mike Boyer through the ropes and out of the ring. Right down there, says the Bruiser, as he goes out after Mike Boyer. The Bruiser slams Boyer into the steps leading up to the ring. And the Bruiser lines up Boyer and slams him head first into the steel ring post. And then the Bruiser eyes our press table. And Boyer up over the table into the chairs. And there goes the table as Dick the Bruiser rearranges the KPLR-TV studio. The Bruiser strangling Boyer and pours ice water over his face, knocking Boyer up against the canvas wall. The Bruiser grabs Boyer and slams Boyer into the ring post.
Put him back in the ring.
Boyer pulled over the steps by the Bruiser. The Bruiser battering Mike Boyer. The Bruiser pitches Boyer through the ropes and into the ring. Boyer battered, stunned. I don't think he knows what town he's in, but I'll bet you he knows who he's wrestling. It's Dick the Bruiser, the most dangerous wrestler alive. The Bruiser battering Boyer. Now the Bruiser mounts the ropes. The crowd screams in delight, and the Bruiser with the atomic drop. And the Bruiser has a victory over Mike Boyer. Dick the Bruiser with his atomic drop polishes off Mike Boyer after destroying Boyer outside the ring.
On Wrestling at the Chase, we have literally followed world heavyweight champion Harley race around the globe. And of course, Race has a big challenge coming up here in St. Louis against Rocky Johnson. But now let's take a whirlwind tour with the world heavyweight champion. The first stop is Japan, and naturally there, the announcer was speaking in Japanese as Race tangled with Tommy Tsuruta. In Australia, Race defended the gold belt against Rick Martel.
Takes him to the middle of a forward body slam, and Martel is very quick, very agile, gets out of it immediately, and the fans going wild with the brilliant showing by the youngster in Rick Martel. Race in trouble. Lock that left arm. No, 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 said Race. That arm up completely with that arm lock there onto Harley Race is Rick Martel. The referee, Ron Hanson, walks away, allowing the match to go on. Race again, the cunning Harley Race onto both knees, forcing Martel to his feet. Martel twisting that arm around forward and backwards, applying pressure over onto the ropes once more, where the referee must release the, tell the wrestlers to release the grip. The count of two, and immediate to the stomach by Race. And Martel is down. Each pitcher tells its own story as Race moves over, pulls Martel by the hair. Lifts him aloft here, now goes right over the top of the body slam to the canvas. Martel, how much of this can he take? A body press by Race, the count of two. But Martel is out of it again. Race to his feet first. Oh, there's a chop by Martel to the stomach of Harley Race. Another one, and another one to the stomach by Martel. And Race is in trouble. An elbow jolt by Martel to Harley Race. Moving in, drops into the stomach. Three dives, four dives. And Race is in trouble now. Tries to move him out, and Martel is into the whip. There he goes, a flying body press. But Race too cunning. The ring cunning showed there. As Martel tried the flying body press, but Race moved out of the way. Takes him again over his shoulder. Lifts him up this time. Holds him there. Aloft there. Could have been a pile driver. Oh, very close to it. And down goes Martel. He's in trouble, Martel. This time, one, two, three, and the match is all over.
Back in the U.S., Race battled Randy Alls in Atlanta.
Harley Race many times uses a highly controversial headbutt. Race drives a knee in. Underhooking those arms. And Alls back to play and Race. Lateral press. Alls powers out, but Alls is in trouble now. Side. Salto by Harley Race. Excellent Greco-Roman move. Race with a high knee lift that puts Alls on the canvas again. I say, Race, the world heavyweight champion, has a very diversified attack. Race's career almost came to a close before he ever got started. He'd been wrestling about 1 year when he was in an automobile wreck that, well, the wrestler said, the doctor said he would never wrestle again, and they doubt if he'd ever walk again. And he not only recuperated, but was able to gain the apex of his career, the World Heavyweight Championship. Race again, driving that knee, glancing it off the head of Randy Alls. Again, Alls smashed in the head. This, of course, has to jar the brain, has to stun the man. Again, Race brings him up. A vertical souple. Race crashing backwards. Randy Alls caught in a vertical souple. A count of three. A count of three. Randy Alls defeated by the world heavyweight champion.
The Fabulous Moolah, ladies' world champion, was on Wrestling at the Chase to meet Winona Littlehart.
And Littlehart, with youth, a lot of fire, a lot of temper, and she's going to have to control it. She walked into one there from Moolah. I don't know what Moolah hit her with. Was it a fist or a forearm? But it sure seemed to shake up Winona Littlehart. With a front face lock, and again, Littlehart is jolted to the mat, either with a fist or a forearm or something, a kick to the back by Moolah. Moolah, another stomp. Oh, she's tough. She is tough. You can bet people like Vicki Williams and Joyce Grable and Debbie Combs are all watching this match to see who has the ladies' title when it's finished, because people like Williams and Combs and Grable and some others who certainly deserve recognition will be looking for a crack at the winner of this match, be it the Fabulous Moolah or Winona Littlehart. Oh, a roundhouse right misses. Littlehart knocks Moolah to the ropes, and then Littlehart pounds away the forearm. Monkey flip by Winona Littlehart. Moolah crawls to the ropes, using those ropes again. And the crowd is not happy with the tactics of the Fabulous Moolah. And Littlehart is so sky high, she's ready to go through the ceiling. She wants to get at Moolah so bad. Moolah steps outside the ring, taking full advantage of the 20 count. a fabulous move. A cagey competitor taking full advantage of the count while her opponent gets more and more worked up.
10 minutes have expired. 10 minutes left.
10 minutes have passed in the first main event today. Drop kick by Little Heart. Didn't land as well as she wanted. Oh, the second drop kick misses. Moore with a knee lift after Little Heart missed the drop kick. Little Heart tossed to the ropes. Oh, what a kick to the abdomen by the fabulous Moore. She banged that one home, and so did Little Heart to the stomach of Moore. Little Heart hanging tough. Moore whipped to the ropes. A tomahawk chop to the throat by Little Heart. She goes for the pin, but can't get it. Drop kick by Little Heart. That one scored. A second drop kick. Moore flipped up and over. A knee press by Winona Little Heart. Oh, Moore counters with a cradle. Count of one, two, and three. The fabulous Moore with a cradle countering the knee press by Winona Little Heart.
Don't go away. Rocky Johnson is on tap. Exciting Rocky Johnson has been blazing hot since returning to St. Louis. Never has Johnson looked better. His speed, his strength, his versatility make Johnson a serious threat to Harley Race. Here is Johnson against Max Blue.
Move just a little bit more, and Blue totally off balance, completely out of whatever strategy he had in mind for this match against Johnson, all because of Rocky's movement. Blue wasn't even near him. Blue dove for the leg and missed, and Rocky just dances away, and the crowd loves it.
Watch Rocky polish off Blue.
Johnson
muscles his way up. Blue twists the arm of Rocky, flips him to the ropes, throws an elbow smash that misses. There's that drop kick from Rocky Johnson. Rocky to the air with a second drop kick.
Blue staggers to his feet. Sunset flip by Rocky Johnson. This could be all over. Oh, no, Blue managed to pop that arm away at the count of two. Rocky with a flying mare. Rocky nearly put Blue away with the sunset flip. Now Johnson lifts Blue into the backbreaker hold, the hanging backbreaker by Rocky Johnson, and Max Blue has no choice but to submit.
Bruce Langford tried to stop Johnson.
Langford catches Johnson in the corner. And a pair of hard blows to the stomach, and then a forearm smash to the neck of Rocky Johnson. Langford with a punch to the top of Johnson's head. That didn't do much good for Langford. An elbow smash to the head. That didn't have much effect either on Rocky Johnson, whose headbutt is quite an effective weapon for him. Langford grabs Johnson's arm, pitches him across the ring to the ropes. Rocky leaps up behind Langford, nips across the ring, catches Langford, grabs that leg and pitches Langford over the top. Langford whipped to the ropes by Rocky Johnson. Drop kick by Rocky Johnson. The flying feet of Rocky Johnson take to the air. Langford dropped by Johnson. Rocky grabs ahead. Lifts Langford over with a suplex. The suplex by Rocky Johnson. He covers Langford. And there's a count of three. A pair of drop kicks followed by the suplex. And Rocky Johnson with that suplex records a victory again.
Take a look at Bill White testing Johnson.
Refuses to budge off those ropes as White tries to pull him. This time, White pitches Johnson. That's why Rocky let him pitch him. And Rocky takes to the air with a drop kick. Rocky nimbly to his feet. White takes another drop kick. Down goes Bill White. Rocky Johnson hooks that head, goes underneath. Oh, shades of Harley Race, the suplex. Shades of the world heavyweight champion, Rocky Johnson, with a suplex. And he covers Bill White. An easy and impressive victory for Rocky Johnson. He was never in trouble.
Johnson also squared off with Juan Zapata.
Zapata working on the face of Rocky Johnson as Johnson's in the corner. Zapata works on the eyes of Rocky Johnson, trying to blind Johnson. Zapata contends to the referee that he was working on the eyebrows above the eyes. Whatever, when you have your eyelids and your forehead raked and scraped while you're perspiring, that stings. That hurts, and Johnson goes to town on Zapata. Johnson belts Zapata. Flying meal by Rocky Johnson. There's the drop kick by Rocky Johnson. Johnson. Zapata knocked across the ring. Rocky lifts Johnson high in the air. Hard body slam. That was a sizzler. Johnson does it again, ramming Zapata to the mat. Rocky Johnson takes Zapata to the ropes, whips him across the ring with one arm. Hard forearm smash. Right underneath the chin. Down goes Zapata. Count of two and three. With the forearm smash. A perfectly legal blow. A forearm smash. Look on his face.
Gil Guerrero tried to break Johnson's winning streak.
Rocky stopped still. Dead still for a moment. Then when Guerrero reached out, Rocky just stepped aside.
Five minutes left.
Rocky Johnson moves behind Gil Guerrero. Guerrero tosses Johnson, comes up with an arm lock on Rocky Johnson. Johnson coming to his feet. Johnson trying to push back on Guerrero, thus loosening the grip, then grabs Guerrero from behind, pitches him to the ropes. Both men hit the ropes. Guerrero ducks. Johnson with a drop kick. Johnson with a second drop kick. Guerrero doesn't know where Johnson's coming from. Rocky, there's that hanging backbreaker. The hanging backbreaker tremendously punishing submission hold. Guerrero screaming in pain, and Gil Guerrero submits quickly. The hanging backbreaker by Rocky Johnson polishes off Gil Guerrero. Still another victory, still another method to gain that triumph from Rocky Johnson.
You've seen Rocky Johnson in action. Now let's talk with the man who very well could be the next world heavyweight champion. Rocky, what a tremendous opportunity for you against Harley Race.
That's right. This is it right now, Larry. This is all the marbles right here. You know, I wrestled Harley Race twice in the past, both times to a draw. Wrestled him in Houston, Texas, and I wrestled him someplace else. When we went to a draw, Harley Race, you didn't beat me. I'll say one thing, I didn't beat you. I was a challenger, I came after you. You're a great champion, you're a great athlete, you're a great wrestler, but this time I've got more determination than I've ever had in my life, Harley, because you got something that belongs to me that I've been chasing for a long time, and that's that world's heavyweight belt. If you notice, Larry, I've changed my style a little bit. I've dropped about 20 pounds, I've changed my tactics. I've been studying that last film I had with Harley Race. One of us will make a mistake, whether it's you or me. And if you make that mistake, Harley Race, I'm going to capitalize. I know how you are. And like I said before, I know you're a fantastic wrestler. You're going to wait for me to make one mistake. But this time, brother, I've been a challenger too long. I've been a challenger all my life. And now it's time for me to become a champion. And I think this time that I don't think anybody can stop me, including you, Harley Race.
You brought up a good point there, Rocky. The pressure is on you. You're the challenger. You have to carry the battle to him. A draw is as good as a win, really, to the champion because he keeps the gold belt. Does that make it more difficult for you because you have to open up more in your attack?
Yes, Larry, it makes it a little bit more difficult, but like I said before, I've been a challenger all my life. I went to Auckland, New Zealand. I was a challenger. I chased the champion over there. He made one mistake. I capitalized on it, and I beat the man and became the New Zealand heavyweight champion. It's all it takes is just that one little mistake. So being a challenger is nothing new to me. Now, I got a little piece of one belt in New Zealand. Now I want the big one where all the gold is, all the marbles, all the pride, all the prestige. You know, I spent 12 years in this business, Larry, and I put everything I had in it, and I don't want to get old. You know, when I come here to St. Louis, these are my kind of people. It's my home away from home, and I can't go out there and let them down because when they're behind me hollering, get it on, Rocky, or go, Rocky, go. It just gives me that little something in there that makes me go. And this time, Harley Race, nobody, like I said before, nobody can stop me, not even you.
Don't you think, too, that one thing that might hurt Race, he's had such a hectic schedule lately. He's on the road, on the go against tough challengers. Is he starting to wear down a little bit? Could he maybe be ripe for the picking?
You know, I've been thinking about that, and I've been studying that, and I've been studying that last film, and I feel that he has slowed down just a little bit from the last time I wrestled him, but I'm not going to underestimate him. I'm not going to go in there like a freight train and say, hey, Daddy, I'm going to go in there and whip this man in 10, 15 minutes. There ain't no way, because Harley Race, you're too clever, you're too smart. That's why you're the world champion. But I'll tell you one thing, when we step over that ring, and I don't want to sound like I'm bragging, it's just that I have so much confidence like I've never had in my life that I'm going to be coming the new heavyweight champion of the world.
King Kong Brody is for one thing and one thing only, and that's himself. I don't need no help from Ken Patera. I don't need help from Dickie Murdoch. I don't need help from nobody. And if Sam Muchnick wants to keep forcing me into a tag match, I'm going to warn him, too, that sooner or later, something's going to happen that you ain't going to have no control over, Muchnick. And in the end, a lot of your top wrestlers are going to pay for it. I'm telling you and everybody else out there, I like being alone.
King Kong Brody made his feelings clear as Brody's former partner Dick Murdoch found out after a match with Pat O'Connor.
Pitched aside by Murdoch. Murdoch gone wild, pounding on O'Connor. He begins strangling Pat O'Connor. Riley tries. Here comes King Kong Brody. Here comes Brody. Here comes Brody. Murdoch and Brody. Toe to toe in the middle of the ring. Brody flattens Murdoch and chases Murdoch outside the ring. King Kong Brody chasing Dick Murdoch back to the dressing room. O'Connor clearly injured. Badly hurt, and King Kong Brody coming to the rescue when Chuck Riley could not control Murdoch.
Brody can be terrifying, and Jerry Polk found out why.
Brody could have pinned him. Brody never satisfied. You heard him tell you, I'm the Sunday morning man. This is gospel when I tell you I can crush anyone, including Andre the Giant. Well, Brody is working on crushing, destroying Jerry Polk right now. Brody biting the forehead of Jerry Polk. Polk already battered and could have been beaten by King Kong Brody. Maybe it will work out to Polk's advantage that he got that respite, that maybe he can fight back. But he better do something soon, I'll guarantee, or his next trip will be down to one of the hospitals on King's Highway. Brody lifts Polk with one arm. Look at that. One arm and just throws him down. King Kong Brody, the one-arm body slam. What will happen when he tries to lift Andre the Giant? Brody again lifts Polk. Takes him across the ring, gives him a backbreaker across the turnbuckle. A backbreaker across the turnbuckle, and then Brody suspends Polk over the top rope and clubs Polk across the jaw. Jerry Polk nearly limp as Brody lifts Polk. Brody again lifts him with one arm, spins him, slams him. Brody lifts that arm, his symbol of triumph, as Brody, with the giant flying knee drop, covers Jerry Polk. King Kong Brody. He just destroyed young Jerry Polk, took him apart piece by piece.
The main event, a one fall with a 20-minute time limit. Introducing from Minneapolis, Minnesota, weighing 245 pounds, Nature Boy Ric Flair.
Flamboyant Ric Flair was on hand to tackle Tommy Sharp.
They all agree the potential is there for this man, Nature Boy Ric Flair, now lifting Tommy Sharp for Ric Flair to be the world champion. There's the atomic knee drop to the tailbone of Tommy Sharp by Nature Boy Ric Flair. Can you imagine what Ric Flair would be like if he had that gold belt strapped around his waist? Can you imagine the conceit he would have then? Think of Buddy Rogers in his prime. Well, I'm sure that Ric Flair would surpass even that. Flair did a hard belt right underneath the eye, caught him along the cheekbone. See a little mouse there from where Tommy Sharp caught him with that punch. Oh, and Sharp walked right into it. But then he gouges the eyes, and hey, Tommy Sharp is hanging tough against Nature Boy Ric Flair. Sharp pounding on the Nature Boy. Ric Flair trapped in the corner by Tommy Sharp. Then a knee lift to the midsection. Flair pins Sharp to the ropes. Sharp fights back. Sharp and Flair toe to toe. Flair up at the groggier of the two. Side headlock. Off the ropes comes Sharp. A flying tackle and floors Flair. Flair ducks. Oh, look out. Flair was waiting with that elbow and banged it home to the chin. Look at punishment and still lash back with some of his own. Flair to the air, flying elbow drop. The flying elbow drop by Nature Boy Ric Flair. One more, says Nature Boy Flair. He hits that rope. A second flying elbow drop by Flair. He hooks the head, brings the arm over the top, and emulating the world champion and trying to do it a lot better than the champion if he can, Ric Flair dives sharp down with the suplex, sharp as a... Now, Punk, now you pay the price, says Ric Flair to Tommy Sharp. Flair brings that leg around. Sharp's out. He's practically unconscious now. He's out, and Flair still not satisfied. Clamps on the figure four leg lock, trying to damage the knees of Tommy Sharp. Sharp cries out as those ligaments and cartilages are stretched in the knee. The figure four leg lock by Ric Flair, refusing to release it. And finally, under threat of disqualification, breaking the figure four leg lock, Nature Boy Ric Flair.
Dick Murdoch and controversy are not strangers. That's obvious from what you've already seen. Now, here is Murdoch in action against fiery Mike Huber.
In his command, slaps Mike Huber, and Huber's not taking anything from Murdoch. You know that Mike Huber is Dick the Bruiser's son-in-law, and he would like a taste of revenge. The drop kick knocks Murdoch into the corner. Mike Huber pounding on the head of Murdoch. Flying heel, Murdoch still with his jacket on.
Murdoch's pure toughness, however, enabled him to bounce back.
Huber staggered. Murdoch taking charge right now. Mike Huber pitched head first into the buckles, and that showed you some of Murdoch's strength right there as he lifted Huber into the air and threw him head first against that buckle. Knee dropped to the head. Shades of Harley Race right there. Another knee drop against the head by Murdoch. The Missouri champion driving his knee into the head of Mike Huber. That's what Harley Race will get, says Dick Murdoch, as he covers Huber, but he can't keep him down. Murdoch thought he had a pin there. Kick right to the head by Dick Murdoch. Another kick to the head. Huber taking a pounding now at the hands of Dick Murdoch. Huber trying to keep his feet. Murdoch smiles, the first time he smiled in this entire battle. Huber refusing to quit, but taking a pounding. Huber fights back with a forearm smash. Murdoch with the uppercut. A brutal display by Missouri State champion Dick Murdoch. Huber lifted. Murdoch keeping his balance. What's he got in mind here? A running body slam? Oh, Murdoch jamming Huber into the mat. A running body slam. This could be it. Oh, Murdoch not content. Now he's going to try to hurt Huber, it looks like. No reason for this at all. But Dick Murdoch, his pride stung, grabs Huber, setting him up for the Texas Brainbuster, the suplex if you prefer. Huber would have been pinned easily before this, but Murdoch wasn't satisfied. Murdoch this time is satisfied, and Dick Murdoch with a vicious demonstration of modern wrestling.
Watching Wrestling at the Chase. This program has been produced by Sam Muchnick in cooperation with the St. Louis Wrestling Club.